Deputy Speaker, honorable members in the House and in the virtual platform, thanks for the opportunity. When Sister Zoliswa Gidi-Diosi received her first Johnson & Johnson vaccine in her left deltoid on the 17th of February 2021, this marked the beginning of a historic campaign to save lives and livelihoods. We have joined more than 87 countries globally in the next phase of our fight against COVID-19, and our program is rapidly gaining momentum. We have now vaccinated 23,059 healthcare workers as of 6 p.m. yesterday, the 22nd. Beyond that cutoff time, we have vaccinated 8,000 health workers in yesterday's working hours, and we are on course to complete 40,000 by this Wednesday, and the provinces have committed to the target of 80,000 vaccines completed in 2 weeks from the date of arrival. It's also my pleasure to announce that the next batch of 80,000 doses of Johnson & Johnson vaccine will arrive this Saturday, the 27th of 2021. Our healthcare workers, who are our frontline soldiers and main defense in fighting this virus, have not been spared the devastating effect of the second wave in South Africa, driven by the 501YV2 variant. Statistics show that in South Africa, healthcare workers are three or four times likely than the general population to develop COVID-19. This is reflected by 54,685 healthcare workers who have been infected in the public sector, with 779 having passed on. They have borne the brunt of the psychological distress of the pandemic by having to fulfill many roles for patients who have been in isolation in their facilities. And for them, vaccination represents hope and relief from the unrelenting pressures of the pandemic. It is for these reasons that we did everything in our power to ensure that the key developments in the characteristics of the virus did not derail us from our plans to begin vaccination in February. We were never asleep. We chose a strategy that was guided by science, and we did not have the financial muscle to make unhedged bets. Our approach has paid off, as we have been able to be nimble and precise around the tricky issue of the variant. The procurement of the vaccines has been a complex process that required negotiations with multinational manufacturers of the vaccines in the face of vaccine nationalism and protectionism. Just recently, it was announced that more than 133 poor countries across the globe have not received a single dose of vaccine, primarily because of the richer countries having utilized their financial muscle to procure vaccines on risk and far in excess of what they need. Be that as it may, even those countries now battle to get the supplies to meet their obligations, as the global production capacity is tested beyond its limit. The fact is that the world has never been here before. We all need the vaccines, and we are now so closely interconnected that there is no choice but to achieve global population immunity. This is the most complex and ambitious public health undertaking in history. Honorable Deputy Speaker, this is why, as government, we have opted to diversify our approach to vaccines procurement by engaging through various mechanisms, bilaterally through continuous engagement with individual manufacturers, multilaterally through the COVAX facility, and regionally through the African Union Vaccine Financing and Vaccine Acquisition Task Team. We have signed non-disclosure agreement with most of the leading manufacturers. This allows us to gain critical insight into their supply lines, their manufacturing plans, and possible blockages in the manufacturing pipeline. It also allows us to pursue negotiations over the prices and volumes and timelines for delivery. It is with these NDAs that certain other conditions come to light. Among these have been principles of indemnity to be provided by government to its citizens for any adverse effects arising from vaccination. Some companies have required that we create an off-all compensation fund as an expression of such indemnity. Having consulted a number of other countries, it has become clear that these conditions are standard across the globe. Our signing of the final agreements has required that we thoroughly consult with Treasury to provide guidance so that the PFMA and all other legislation is upheld before final agreements are signed. This process has proven to be quite onerous because we find ourselves without precedence in this situation. Once all these contracts are signed, they will be available for Treasury and the Auditor General's Office for perusal. We are also raising this issue just to correct an erroneous impression that there are questions that we are avoiding because of NDAs. Rather, it should be understood that the NDAs must be respected in order to protect the process of timely acquisitions, but we will make that information available when it is ready to this particular House. We have also asked our Ministerial Advisory Committee on Vaccines to do regular reviews on available information about vaccines. In the latest advice they've given us, they grouped the vaccines into three groups. The first groups of vaccines are those for current implementation that we should see considered for immediate use. These involve Johnson & Johnson, Moderna and Pfizer. So those of you who have got doubts, please understand that we've got a consensus on this one. We have placed huge orders on Johnson & Johnson and Pfizer, which will be finalized in the next few days and announced when concluded. Whilst discussions are ongoing with Moderna, we have not reached any finality. The second category are the vaccines which we have an interest in and appear to be promising on available data, but currently require additional technical information. These involve the Gamaleya Sputnik V Russia from Russia, Sinopharm and Sinovac from China. For these candidates, NDAs have also been signed, so we're getting more information and our negotiations are advanced. They have offered several millions of vaccines subject to finalization of outstanding information and price negotiations. Under our guidance, they've made submissions to SAHPRA, proposals have been made for joint research to be undertaken as well. We're also engaging the Cuban government on their own vaccine. The final group are the vaccines that may not be suitable for immediate use that need additional work to be done. These include AstraZeneca and Novavax. These relate more to the condition of the variant, and these vaccines can be well utilized in different parts of the world. So those who think of them as being useless and rotten and so on are completely off the line. We are constantly being pushed to deliver for delivery lines and are often criticized for not providing these whilst there are still negotiations. We must indicate that these are only solidified once the payment is made. Even then, we, like anyone else in the world, are at the mercy of the manufacturers to meet their commitment. So far as AstraZeneca and Johnson & Johnson have honored they honored their commitments to South Africa and delivered when they said they would. It is important to say that governments and private manufacturing companies are interested in keeping their promises because our fortunes are tied together. And I must also say that we're working together with the private sector in this regard, and some of the members who have raised issues about private sector, I'm not sure which private sector they're talking about. As the first country to roll out one-dose regimen, this means that we're able to complete and certify hundreds of thousands of health care workers as right off the bat, so that we can gain time and numbers as in that respect. By pursuing vaccination under the Sisonga Protocol, which allowed us to use Johnson & Johnson batches that had already been certified by SAHPRA under research conditions, we'll be one of the very few nations to undertake a well-designed impact assessment as we roll out vaccines to our healthcare workers. The information will not only be valuable for ourselves, but particularly as we battle for 541 V2 variant, and this also benefits the whole world. Department of Health and Treasury have concluded a proposal that will provide a mechanism to compensate any citizens who suffer from adverse effects from Johnson & Johnson and Pfizer vaccine. In principle, this proposed mechanism would provide recourse for any adverse effect suffered by any vaccine that has been approved for all by SAHPRA. The Minister of Finance will make the necessary announcement in his budget speech. Honourable members, allow me to take the opportunity also to correct some misunderstanding around the vaccine rollout strategy. While some continue to grandstand and spread myths and disinformation around the vaccine rollout strategy and the effectiveness of the vaccine, we have procured the vaccines that are good for us and have successfully started the vaccination for healthcare workers across the country. A well-designated study by HSRC showed that 67% of citizens are definitely ready to have the vaccine, and only 12% might be uncertain or would not like to take the vaccine. So this does indicate that the level of interest in the vaccine is high, but we are therefore encouraged to see that all of this work is indicating we must just continue our communication to strengthen that attitude. We've also seen, now that the vaccine is being rolled out, that in reality is high appetite amongst healthcare workers As of today, we have more than 500,000 registration on the electronic vaccination districts data system. We're aware that over the weekend there was much higher turnout of private practitioners than we expected. This for us is a sign that there's confidence in the vaccine and of course in the Queen Songa protocol. It must also be understood that MRC and the Department of Health are working together in this matter. It's one phase, it's one aspect of the same plan that involves all of us. The President and myself and also several other leaders have received our J&J vaccine. The decision to have some leaders take the vaccination first was not taken lightly. It came as a result of various debates and consultation. Communities clearly relayed the need to see that the government is able to allay their fears on the J&J vaccine, and therefore it gave lots of confidence to our health workers. This has proven to be motivating, and I also want to thank the union leaders for the work that they've done in this regard. With regards to the AstraZeneca vaccine, the stock has been sold to the African Union. Not donated, it's been sold, and they will be buying, and it will be distributed in the next few days. We have learned from the AU that, in fact, we have now got a win-win situation where out of this situation, almost 20 countries in the continent will actually benefit as they will use this for the healthcare workers in the areas where, in fact, AstraZeneca works well and they've got no challenge of the variant. We have been in touch with the WHO and we've all agreed that the AstraZeneca vaccine is good to use in different parts of the world. Of course, in our case, we have to just be careful because of the particular variant. We must commend His Excellency President Ramaphosa for his leadership, and we also congratulate him for being declared a champion for the COVID-19. He has played a critical role in securing vaccines for the continent. Were it not for President Ramaphosa's proactive stance, we would have had a challenge in the continent, and he has actually helped to lift the continent through all the work he has done, even in the provision of diagnostics, in the provision of vaccine. We want to say thank you very much, President Ramaphosa. He has also spearheaded the whole program of local manufacturing of the vaccine in South Africa in working together with the BRICS countries, and we also commend that work. Let me just say to the honorable members, thank you very much for your comments, and we welcome all the suggestions. But Honorable Kwakhube, we really can't cure the DA from his schizophrenic
You are incompetent.
The real issue is they, on the one side, in Western Cape, they are part of this plan of rollout with the national...
You are incompetent.
On the other side, they are also...
Order, honourable member.
On the other
you
side,
can't do that.
They want to take
us to... Speaker, point of order.
They would not have been able to win the case in court because the information they are looking for is already available. I want to thank you, Honourable Kenny Jacobs, for your lecture. It's wonderful, and
you are incompetent.
Made available for the members.
Honourable Ndlozi, stop your incompetence.
Point of order.
Point of order.
Benefit quite a lot from
we have done exceptionally well, Minister.
Of all the issues that
we'll
you
deal with,
and the honourable Tenjiwayo, we just want to say that we. I'm noting your point, but we want to say that the President has actually done a lot to help in the continent
Deputy
on all of
Speaker.
This issue. And then, Honorable Sengwa, we have
Deputy
the
Speaker.
Issue around the power...
What are you raising on, Honorable Member?
I want to find out if the Honorable Gentleman will take a question.
Honorable Minister?
No, after I'm done, I can consider it.
Yeah.
The hospitals and the facilities that are hosting the vaccines will have generators to deal with the problem. And the
point of order.
Members, Honorable Swart,
there
should be no corruption in this regard. And we also agree with Honorable August and Tseke and Honorable Imam.
Point of order, Deputy Speaker.
All the vaccines need a consent.
What's the point of order?
The point of order is that the minister is incompetent. How do you vaccinate 23,000 people in 14 days?
Honourable Member, that's not a point of order. That's not a point of order.
Incompetent.
Allow the minister to talk.
Honourable Member, that's not a point of order. Chief Whip?
Then just to say
Honourable Deputy Speaker, with due respect, we cannot allow what Honourable Ndlozi is doing.
Yeah.
And as per the procedures and the guidelines of virtual meetings, he must be taken out of the platform. Because
we are in a crisis, Comrade Majodini. How do you speak rules when people are incompetent to vaccinate people?
This is a crisis. Honorable Ndlozi,
speaker, please do not allow
you switch him off. Can you switch him off, please? Honorable Ndlozi must not speak. Switch him off.
Finally, honorable members of the House, may I conclude by reminding our citizens that the containment measures of washing the hands, social distancing, sanitizing remain important and enforce until we achieve population immunity. We'll have to continue with it while the vaccination program is in progress. And let me say once again, we will be able to vaccinate as many South Africans as need to be, and our plan is in place. And thank you very much.